Once I was a student, I had to pick up my degree. And I thought about the years gone by, the years that number three. How things that had seemed important turned out to be a joke. And things that had seemed natural had all gone up in smoke. And an earlier crowd had come to see me win my prize.
Authenticity in music, how to be a real musician in times of retromania. My name is Pauwke Berkers from Erasmus University Rotterdam, and together with Julian Schaap, who's somewhere in the back but I can't see him, and Niels van Poecke, we are coordinating music talks. Before I give Niels, Henries and Susie the floor to also introduce the debate on authenticity, let's just say a few words about music talks. So first, what is music talks about? Well, music talks is a collaboration between first the Department of Arts and Culture Studies, Erasmus University Rotterdam. We deliver academic content in a hopefully non-academic way. Second, grounds, providing us with a home and a sort of a sense of belonging, and the music itself. Third, Rood Kapje, giving artistic contextualization to the theme. And this very edition, you saw Twan Klaas, so first give another round of applause for him. And we work with several other partners, amongst others SG Erasmus and our friends from the PopUnie. and these ingredients together will produce, we hope, two more, let's say, interdisciplinary love babies or little Frankensteins, if you will, and where we combine along each theme science, music, and art. So what are these themes? Too quick. Classic instructor-lecturer mistake. The first one started with gender, was in the small room over there. Then the last one on music and creative scenes we did here as well. Today, as you know, we talk about authenticity. And the last one, that is sort of a change in schedule, which was supposedly about selling music online. But we got an offer we couldn't refuse, so to speak. So we're going to talk about festivals and festivalization because Peter Koudstaal, who made a magnificent photo book on music festivals, he will also launch his book at that date. So write in your agenda 29th of April. It's not the easiest date, but I hope you will still come. So why do we want to organize music talks? Well, first of all, we feel it's important that academia or university in general, that we really part of society and Rotterdam, and that we're not in an inaccessible island, Woudestein in this case, where people talk a completely different language. As such, we want to hold this event in Rotterdam West. We want to have it for free. We try to speak a non-academic language, and we like to talk with you, but also listen to you and the people active in the Rotterdam music scene. Second of all, we also feel responsible for our arts and culture studies students, to also offer platforms where they can talk and meet and mingle with people from the music sector, where also a lot of our alumni find jobs. And last of all, in contrast to what Iggy Pop says, it's just really fun to do these kinds of things, which of course is a very important driver to actually do events like that. To paraphrase, I think one of the realest pop musicians that ever lived, I think we have to move it. And I give the floor to Niels.
Yeah, thank you, Pauwke, for this nice introduction. My name is Niels van Poecke. I am a PhD candidate and a lecturer at the Department of Arts and Culture Studies. In my PhD, I study authenticity in relation to contemporary folk music, which is why I am the curator and the co-presenter of today. I say co-presenter because as the entire Music Talks event is the product of co-creation, this edition on authenticity is the product of a cooperation between Erasmus University and Codarts. So I will be co-hosting this event together with Henries Vonk, who's sitting here at the front, working at the artistic department of Codarts, and with Susie Nagy-Sandor, who is a former master student of arts and culture studies, graduated on authenticity in Hungarian folk music. So we are going to discuss authenticity today. And I promise you right away that this is a very complicated issue. Only by looking at the etymological meaning of the term, things are getting confused. So it comes from the Greek authentikos, which refers to the objective dimension of the concept of authenticity, so that objects, music, can be seen as authentic or original or genuine. But it also refers to a subjective dimension. The word authentikes in Greek means a person who is acting on his own authorization. Furthermore, the term has both a positive or a lightning connotation in the meaning of a person or an individual that is a authentes. But there's also a more pessimistic or even dark side to the term, as authentes also means a person who is a perpetrator, a murderer, or even a self-murderer or a suicide. So in the context of popular music, we only need to think about the so-called Club of 27 to see what this dark side of authenticity actually refers to. So it's a complicated issue, but the aim of tonight is to unpack this issue together with our guests and also together with you, the audience, to create some form of coherence out of the fragmentary. And how are we planning to do this? We will kick off with a presentation by Barbara Titus from the University of Amsterdam, who is going to explore the notion of authenticity in relation to her fieldwork in South Africa on Maskanda music. Then we will invite two musicians to the stage, Lucky Fonz III, a Dutch folk musician, and Kudsi Erguner, a Turkish Sufi musician, to explore authenticity from their personal experiences and also in reference to their own artistic practices. Then you're up for something really special because Mr. Erguner and his companion Michalis Cholevas are also going to perform music. Afterwards, we're going to take a break of 15 minutes and then we have two more interview rounds. We're going to invite people working in the music industry and in education, George Caird from Codarts and Koen ter Heegde, the label manager from Subroutine Records, to explore authenticity with them. And then we'll end the evening with an interview with Professor Dick Houtman from Leuven University to zoom out a little bit and see what is the link between authenticity and broader dynamics within society, and also to look more at the historical genesis of the term. Each interview round will last 20 minutes, and we will have reserved 10 minutes for questions from the audience. Now, one more final thing. So the starting point of this discussion on authenticity can be found in a book by Simon Reynolds, a British music critic, who published a book in 2011 titled Retromania, in which he argues that we are currently living in a pop age gone loco for retro and crazy for commemoration. Somewhat more specifically, he defines retromania as the fascination for fashions, fads, sounds, and stars that occurred within living memory, or even more popular, as an incurable addiction towards the past, which has become immediate with the emergence of social media, especially YouTube. He basically argues that innovation or creativity is no longer possible, but that we are sort of stuck to the past. We can only recycle the past and heading towards some sort of cultural ecological disaster, as he argues. Or as he also says, neophilia, the longing for innovation and originality, has become necrophilia. Now this raises all kinds of questions. First and foremost, whether Reynolds' analysis of contemporary popular music is an accurate one, whether popular music isn't per definition oriented towards the past, and if Reynolds is right in saying that popular music suffers from retromania, what then lies beyond it? So these are some of the broader questions which we are going to discuss and explore, but I first want to give the floor to Barbara Titus, who was a visiting professor at the University of KwaZulu-Natal in Durban, South Africa, and in 2013 was appointed associate professor of cultural musicology at the University of Amsterdam. And in her presentation, she will explore the notion of authenticity in music through her field work on South African Maskanda music. Please give a big round of applause to Barbara Titus.
Thanks, Niels, for this kind invitation. Thanks for enabling me to be here. I'm just putting this up a little bit. Everybody able to hear me? That's good, because I actually would like to start this presentation by playing the ball to you a little bit and make a kind of inventory of what we actually mean when we talk about authentic or inauthentic music. And I think we've all not only ideas about, you know, when music is authentic and when music is inauthentic, but we also really have, I think, very strong feelings about when that is the case or not. And maybe we can find some words here right now about, you know, when you really feel that music is authentic or really not authentic. Is there anybody who would like to comment on that?
You can just raise your hand if you want.
There's a microphone that can go around. Without any force. So music is authentic when it's not, when there's not any force condition. And what do you mean with condition?
Well, I think unconditioned.
Yeah. Unconditionally. Onvoorwaardelijk.
No, well, or we say in Dutch, we say ongeconditioneerd. Niet geconditioneerd. But I don't know the word in English for that.
Unconditioned. Yeah. And can you describe a little bit further when that is the case?
Well,
can you give an example? Or
perhaps when your individuality is very concentrated, perhaps.
Yeah. So very much loyal to your own self,
I
in a way?
I think so, So not being disturbed by other influences.
Yeah, loyal to yourself.
Pure.
Any other qualifications about this? I'm sure there are more. Yeah? And a hand over there.
Yeah, for me it has to do with creativity.
Creativity,
So when musicians really are able to do something else with their instruments.
Yeah.
Or with lyrics or with their performance.
So something that you have not heard before, something unheard of even?
No, not necessarily. More like, for example, when a band plays blues music, but they do it, they play with those elements which make blues music. So
right.
Become more like honest or...
Yeah.
Yeah.
But in a way then also there is a pact really between the audience and the musician, because the audience knows what these ingredients are, right? Where what the musicians are playing with. So in a way there's also a mutual understanding of what's going on.
Yeah, probably. Yeah. I think it requires a certain audience as well to get it, probably.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Any other dimensions of authenticity? Niels was just talking about retromania, the past, yeah?
I think authenticity, you can say it is music that is made by themselves, so by music instruments that made this by themselves. It's only music that can exist by themselves.
So again, a sort of loyalty to your own creativity and your own...
Yeah, to your own culture, for example.
Own culture, so not only as an individual, but also as a group of people?
Yeah, as a group, as a society.
As a society,
that everybody knows and everybody understands.
So there's also a shared set of what you understand certain music to be or how it should be performed.
Yeah, for example.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. I see very much in all the responses this idea of loyalty, that you're either loyal to yourself as an individual or loyal to a community or share some experiences of music that you both understand as an audience or as a musician. For me, authenticity also has a dimension of longing into it. That if you hear certain music, it reminds you not only maybe of a time that is past or something that was and that you recognize, but as Niels sort of hinted at with the sort of retromania dimension, but also a place, or that this music can bring you there in a way, or functions as a substitute for it. Is that something that you can imagine when I talk about it in that way? That's authentic music is music that brings you somewhere, whether that's in time or space. Nostalgia, yeah, and I think nostalgia is also a very important aspect of retromania, right, Niels? With the indeed, nostalgia is a big subject. Yeah, okay. So that's actually yeah. There's one more remark. Yeah.
One more because is it on?
It's on. Yeah.
Because you refer to this longing for something
yeah.
past, and I think to look at the word originality because
yes.
on your slide you
yes.
put up that it was original.
Yep.
In the definition.
Yeah.
And if originality in common parlance now is to do with creativity, obviously.
Yes. Yes.
But it is also to do with where things originated.
Yes. That's so interesting
so
about the word originality, right?
So originality yeah, yeah. has got a double meaning.
It
and
it
I
has,
think this
yeah.
into the word authenticity,
yeah, yeah.
this ambiguous double meaning.
Ambiguous of something very old and timeless and something very new and creative at the same time.
Precisely.
Yeah, yeah, thanks. Thanks for bringing that in. That's very important. Okay, so this actually gives me a lot of material also to start off my presentation, which is... which has these references both to loyalty to a place or time and longing to a certain place or time. So yes. So I would like to start my presentation with really the cliche case among the authenticity debates: Bob Dylan going electric at the Newport Folk Festival in 1965. There, as I think most of us know, Dylan took on an electric guitar, much to the dismay of some of his fans. And the longing for a faraway space that folk represented was violated, and the loyalty to the conventions that had enabled folk's revival was betrayed. And even now, I think there are people who say that Bob Dylan was authentic when he used acoustical instruments and became inauthentic when he went electric. And apparently these people not only think, as I just said, but also vehemently believe that acoustic instruments are more authentic tools for transmitting folk than amplified instruments. And Elijah Wald, in his recent monograph, Dylan Goes Electric, you see the cover here on the PowerPoint, explains that this belief reaches far beyond the sounding aspects of the music, that it represents a shared set of political views, generational positions, class distinctions, etc. And as a musicologist, I'm interested in the ways in which such beliefs emerge, how they are steered and sometimes even manipulated by governments, music industries, media, educational institutions, but also notably ourselves, individuals, and how these beliefs consciously and subconsciously become widely shared among a group of people. I unpack those roles, the roles of these institutions, the governments, the media, the music industry, and I explain how sometimes musical features are being used to represent a musical practice as authentic or inauthentic. So, for instance, the sound of an electric guitar is disqualified as a means of performing folk. It's considered inauthentic. You think, well, maybe we talk about the sound of this guitar, but it's about much more than this sound, right? It's actually about loads of things behind it. In order to unpack all those things behind it, I first have to acknowledge that my own experiences of authenticity, my own distinctions between what is authentic and what is inauthentic music, also emerge from a belief system that I share with my peers. I need to acknowledge that, for instance, my inclination to call music inauthentic when it has been modified by autotune, really does not have much to do with the sound of the music at all. It has to do with my cultured ideas about how music should be produced by the human body. And it has to do with my unwillingness to acknowledge that autotune, just like an acoustic guitar, can be used as a technological extension of that human body. Autotune violates my sense of cultural belonging, a sense that I share with a good deal of people, but that is also to some degree individually assumed. So in this presentation, I'd like to do a little bit of unpacking in the 15 minutes that I have. Demonstrate how governments, industries, media, educational infrastructures shape our senses of cultural belonging and hence our experiences with authenticity. And I do this by means of looking at South African Maskanda music, which I've been researching for the past years. Who's ever heard of Maskanda music? Who knows something about it? Yeah, that's, yeah, of course, Marloes knows, because Marloes has studied with me. I'm not surprised that not many of you know what this music is, so I will tell you a little bit about it. Maskanda, as you see here again on the slide, is a solo guitar practice. It emerged in the early 20th century, when hundreds of thousands of black South Africans were forced to move to towns and mines for work. And there, in those towns, they encountered instruments, musical instruments. They heard ragtime on the radio. They heard music from various churches. And they reworked all these musical experiences into a new genre that they also felt was not entirely theirs. So also the people who played Maskanda in the early 20th century experienced this music as hybrid, not the real Zulu music. And existing songs were basically transplanted on the guitar, but also the violin, the concertina. And musical idiom and tonalities from existing rural musical practices, such as you see on the bao, the umakuyana bao, and the multi-part singing, the amahubo singing, were combined with Anglican church music and boerenmuziek. Currently, Maskanda is consumed as local pop music in public spaces in the province of KwaZulu-Natal in South Africa, so supermarkets, taxis, anywhere. And Maskanda is also enjoyed by world music audiences in Europe and the United States, North America generally, I would say. Ironically, despite its obvious musical hybridity, over the years, Maskanda has become a marker of Zulu identity. And this happened especially during the apartheid years between 1948 and 1994, when there were separate radio stations, separate record labels, separate music schools, separate dress codes for all South African communities imposed by a totalitarian state. And this was consciously done to keep the people of South Africa apart. So cultural policy and cultural distinction was very important to implement this apartheid policy. And it was regulated. That's, I think, very important to note, that notions of authenticity, of what was authentic music, those notions were entirely regulated by this totalitarian state that controlled all media, all industries, and all educational systems. So what you get then is this. You see here a random number of LP covers, CD covers of Maskanda music during the apartheid years. And you see also in this imagery, I hope, that framing Maskanda as an exclusively Zulu musical practice fitted the political aims of the government, portraying Zulu people as physical, rhythmical, rural, and warrior-like. And this stereotypical image was embraced by many Zulu South Africans themselves, not in the least, for instance, the Zulu royal house that was a kind of extension of the apartheid government in really consciously constructing a very homeland-like culture. This imagery, this portrayal, was imposed from above by a totalitarian state, and it limited the opportunities of Zulu South Africans to express themselves, since they were supposed to fit into this racist and stereotypical idea of Zulu culture. Nevertheless, at present, many Zulu South Africans consider Maskanda to be traditional, and they consider it to be in powerful ways authentic Zulu music. And I can tell you, after years of research, there are many ways why this makes sense. That's really what made me think about you know, the qualification of authenticity. Moreover, many of the racial and cultural stereotypes of Zulu and more broadly African culture and music, like being rhythmical, being repetitive, being physical, being dance orientated, not only served the South African apartheid government's aim to divide and rule, it also serves the South African and global music industries that have to sell this music as a recognizable product to an audience that has very specific assumptions about what African culture is. And often these ideas, these assumptions are age-old and very stereotypical ideas about Africa as a country rather than a continent, in which people are simpler, live closer to nature, work with their bodies rather than their minds, and do everything collectively. And these assumptions lead to musical preferences that are strikingly similar to those of early Bob Dylan fans about folk. Musicians should play on acoustical instruments. They should have unpolished voices. They should use repetitive motives. They should demonstrate metrical and rhythmical complexity. And they should attend to collective and participatory music making. And especially a global world music audience is inclined to regard music from Africa as less authentic if it does not fit in with these imposed limitations. And I only have to mention the names of, for instance, Youssou N'Dour or Angélique Kidjo, who feel really seriously restricted in their artistic possibilities due to these ideas about what African music should be and what kind of African music does sell as African music. With this background information in your minds, I would like to carry out a little experiment with us here in the room. And this experiment that should show you why I think we should stop trying to ascertain what makes music authentic and start asking questions why certain people find certain music authentic. I think we should ask the why questions, not the what questions. So what I'm going to show you is two examples of contemporary, more or less contemporary 1990s Maskanda, post-apartheid. Susie, how much time do I have? Few minutes? Okay, I will make them short, the samples. The first sample you will hear is by Mfasumnyama. Mfasumnyama is one of the most famous Maskandi in South Africa, or was, before he passed away. And his music is regarded by his large Zulu South African audience as authentic Zulu cultural heritage. What you see is a very carefully staged, choreographed performance. The second sample that I will play immediately afterwards is by Shanin Kobo, who was playing at the World Music Festival in Nantes, in France, in 1997. And this is completely different footage. It's private footage in the made in the after hours of the festival. It's a private video recording. It's not officially staged. But there's a lot of performativity going on there. And Kobo's music is highly regarded among international world music aficionados. And he regularly performed on world music festivals in Europe, the US, and Asia. But in South Africa, he is hardly known. So what I would like you to do is, I play them. I would like you to pay attention to the playing of the guitarists. Also pay attention to the liveness of it. Of course, there's a whole debate also going on about authenticity and liveness, right? I'm not going to go into there, but it's an interesting dimension. Pay attention to how the musicians are dressed, how they interact with the audience, how the audience responds to them. So I will now play you short samples of those two musicians, and then I will wrap up. There we go. So this is Mfaso Mnyama, who is really wildly popular in South Africa. Okay, so these two examples sum up my points. For some, Nkobo's music is authentic because it responds to their idea of what African music is. It's solo, it's acoustic, it's small scale, it's an unpolished voice. And for others, Mfaso Mnyama's music is authentic because it responds to their idea of what African music is. Watch the dress, the musicians being clad in animal skins, the prominence of the drums, the collective dancing. And the question we should ask ourselves is not which one is more authentic, but the question, why do people think the one is more authentic than the other? And how do these judgments come about? In order to tackle such questions, as I said, we first need to acknowledge that our own notions of authenticity have also been formed by the cultural norms through which we live and think. Those imposed on us from childhood onwards, the way in which media replicate these norms and images, and the industry's attempts to conform to this imagery in order to sell their products. This also means the acknowledgement of the tension between our senses of individuality and the cultural and encultured collective in which we operate as individuals. And for this, and this is really the last thing I say, for this I'd like to give the last word to Brian, in the life of Brian and his disciples. Brian, who really aptly echoes Dylan in trying to get away from his fans. So the last word goes to Brian.
Two things to say.
Tell us both of them.
Look, you've got it all wrong. You don't need to follow me. You don't need to follow anybody. You've got to think for yourself. You're all individuals.
Yes, we're all individuals.
You're all different.
Yes, we are all different.
I'm not.
Thank you. As a token of our gratitude, we've got you a little gift. And in it, you'll find something very locally authentic from Rotterdam, and also something testifying to your own authenticity. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Barbara. So if you have any questions for Barbara, just please keep them. There will be an opportunity to ask them, as well as to Kudsi Erguner and Lucky Fonz. So we're now going to talk about authenticity from the perspective of being a musician. And you could ask yourself, what is actually the value of authenticity when being a musician? Is it something to work with or to relate to? Or is it actually just a thing that scientists like to talk about but doesn't really play a major role when creating or performing music? And if it plays a role, how do you find your personal authenticity? And what is the role of intermediaries and audiences indeed in determining what is authentic and what is not? To discuss these and more questions, we've invited two musicians. First and foremost, Kudsi Erguner, who is a Turkish Sufi musician and a master of the ney flute, launching his musical career in 1969 as a member of the Istanbul Radio Orchestra. He moved to Paris in the 1970s to study architecture and musicology. He's a founder of the Mevlani Institute for the Study of Classical Music and Sufi Culture, and he is currently affiliated to Codarts Music Conservatory Rotterdam, where he is an artistic leader Ottoman music. Please give a warm welcome to Mr. Kudsi Erguner. Welcome. Mr. Erguner will be joined by Otto Wiggers, more known as Lucky Fonz III, who is a Dutch folk musician. And starting his career in 2005, during his studies at the University of Amsterdam, he has released 6 studio albums so far, of which his latest album, titled Ingen Naki, But Naked in English, was released last Friday. He is regarded as one of the most renowned live acts in the Netherlands, and as I know him, also one of the most talkative musicians in the Netherlands. Please put your hands together for Lucky Fonz III. So, Lucky, like I said in my introduction, you just released your 6th album last Friday. How's it going? Did you already receive some reviews?
Yes, it's all happening now. It's doing really well. It's like, In fact, I've never had such a reception. So it's been a sort of a weird week where every 2 hours I get messages from my manager saying, oh, it's going up in the charts.
Wow.
It's going up.
Yeah. That's really good. Congratulations. Yeah. Is the word authentic already mentioned?
Oh, yes. It's already. In fact, I got an email today by a fan who was highly disappointed because she had seen me perform with my harmonica and my guitar.
Yeah.
And the record I put out is produced with lots of sounds, like there's lots of electronic sounds in it.
Yeah, it's the
old thing. It's like, you know, it's Bob Dylan Newport all over again. So I have fans saying now, so, oh, I'm so, I wish you, couldn't you have done it in the authentic way? They actually use that word. Whereas they even think that there might be a producer that's sort of like pushing me to do this or that.
Yeah.
So, you know, they think of reasons why I could have possibly behaved in such an inauthentic way. But the truth is, I wanted to make that music. I can't deal with other people's notions of authenticity.
Yeah, exactly. So we're getting back to you very shortly. I first want to also ask some questions to Mr. Erguner. As I said in my introduction, you're a Mevlani Sufi musician. We made a small movie clip showing you performing at the University of Music Franz Liszt in Weimar. It's a very short clip, unfortunately, because the piece is actually 50 minutes and it's very beautiful. I suggest to first watch it, and then afterwards I want to ask you to explain in a nutshell what Sufi music or Mevlani Sufi music is according to you. This is how it sounds, yes. So now we've heard it, could you maybe explain it briefly? What is Sufi music, according to you?
This is a very deep question. We always have the difficulty to find the right answer. Because I should say this Sufi music is the music appreciated by the Sufi people. So now we come to the problem of the modernity. Are there any Sufi people to appreciate it? That's another question. So in the exposition that we heard, we forgot one point, the listeners. The listeners is sometimes more important than the musician himself.
The audiences.
The audience, yeah. And so what we call the Sufi music today, we have a huge big heritage of the compositions accompanying some ceremonies, rituals, and poetry of Sufi people. And this repertoire is really very extraordinary and rich repertoire. So when it is played, it should be called Sufi music. But in its reality, we need audience, Sufi audience, to appreciate it.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you. Kudsi, I may call him Kudsi because we are colleagues. Yeah. We have a quote also from you. Because we know for a fact that you were born and raised in this Sufi tradition, and actually your father was your first teacher.
Yes.
On the Nay. And there's a beautiful quote that we found from you about the Nay, that the human being has some sort of secret nostalgia, here the word comes up again, within himself. Perhaps the sound of the Nay can awake this feeling. So can you tell us the importance of the Nay in your Sufi Mevlana tradition?
Let me explain. Luckily, I have my instrument with me on the stage. This is a piece of reed. So as you see, we have sections on the reed. So the Ney player takes the piece of reed and clean inside, and then he can blow and make a sound out of it. So the Sufi poet, which is Celaleddin Rumi, for those who knows him, he started to his big book of teaching called Methnevi, saying that Bishnavi Nechun Hikayet Mikune, listen to the Ney, to the reed flute, who has a history to tell you. He is complaining from a separation. And then he commented these verses in 24,000 verses. So I'm not going to recite all of them. But the metaphor in this, human being should be like a piece of reed. He has his sections, his obstacles, his in his nature, to become to make impossible some influences more higher than his nature to pass through him. So, like the breath of the Ney player passing through the Ney. So the meaning of the Ney for the Sufi people is coming from this metaphoric poetry, and it's been this instrument has been listened as a wise man's speech all the time. And so the authenticity is also related to this metaphoric. Mm. So have to be limpid, have to be clear enough to transform the influences that you have, inspirations that you have, real inspirations, into a musical language or into a word or any fine art. So of course there are some criteria of the tradition, but the traditions we know that are made also by the innovations.
And can you before we continue on that aspect of the innovation, maybe go back a little bit to that concept of authenticity within the Sufi tradition? How do you relate to that? What does that mean to you?
Well, first of all, to understand the authenticity, we need to know what is false. We don't have much idea about what is false. To me, music is like a language that you learn. There is also an art to learn how to do it. But it doesn't mean that you have something to say out of it. Let me give the example of a very important personality of the Arabic Islamic world, which is Al-Farabi. He wrote a book called Big Book of Music, Kitab Kebir al-Muski, which starts with this image, explaining who is the musician. He imagines a woman who loved his wife, his husband, and his husband is dead, and she starts to sing a lamentation. This is a very extraordinary and authentic moment of the music. But 1 month later, if you ask her to sing the same thing, she cannot, because she's not a musician. The only thing that you can do, if you prepare her talking about her husband and this, how he's dead, the funeral, etc., she feels herself again in this situation and she can sing. But it's not still a musical activity. The musician is the one who you ask him to play a lamentation, he can play a lamentation as well as her singing at that moment. So, which means that in the sense of authenticity, if you compare to the theater, for example, you have on the stage an actor playing the role of a beggar. He is not a real beggar. His profession of actor is...
He's performing.
And he is nearly real. You believe to what he does. But there is also a real beggar on the stage. Nobody pay any attention to him. So most of the time, the art is an imitation of the reality. But to do it, you have to learn how to do it.
So if I understand you correctly, as a musician or as an artist, you have to perform your authenticity in such a way that the audience grasps it as an authentic performance.
Absolutely, okay. Absolutely. Yeah. Because it's my problem if I am really authentic with what I do.
Lucky, you want to say something?
I agree.
Yeah. Can I ask you, how do you do this? Because you are playing music in a tradition and you also relate to this tradition. Mm-hmm. But is there a way that you also maybe play with this tradition or tweak the tradition or add different styles or genres to it? Do you stay true to the origin? There was this distinction made before between origin and originality. How do you see this distinction?
But I should say, in the, to go with the comparison of the idea that music is a language. So there are many people which they know how to speak, but they don't know anything to say. So the authenticity brings you to have things to say.
Yeah.
So to have things to say, music is not something isolated as an art. This all word, the literature, the your own experience, your way of living, your circle of friends, the things that you heard and you enjoyed and you are getting influences, that makes sense in what you
but
do.
But does it then mean that you can add virtually everything to the tradition of the Sufi music?
Of course, absolutely.
And if that is...
That's my taste. But if I can share it with some Sufi people, it will become a Sufi music.
Okay.
So I think when we made a Skype, I thought I gave you this image because if you consider the artist like a bean,
like a bee, yeah,
like a bee,
the animal.
I said bean. I'm sorry. The bee, if you put him in the garden of rose, he makes honey of rose. If you put in a garden of acacia, he will make a honey of acacia. If you put just some sugar on it, he will make a honey of glucose. So now we have to think more than authenticity, how to fit the artistic environment to make something tasty. Mm. Now the problem, our problem is that we don't think about the environment, how an artist is receiving new ideas, new decisions, new feelings. And all this is missing in the reflection. And I personally, I had many time with this problem of authenticity because when I started in the 70s with the Whirling Dervish ceremonies and concerts, and people there saying, are they authentic? No. That's not the question. The question is, when you see, for example, a ceremony of whirling dervishes, do they feel really what they do or not? This is in them. You cannot judge that. But there are some criteria of this ceremony. It should be done as it is. Yeah. In the music also, when you play Mozart, what you call authentic Mozart, there are has its own criteria. Okay, so every musical language has also his way of expression. What we call authenticity, it's the conformity to this.
Okay, so maybe to stay within this metaphor of the bee, as a musician, you can go from flower to flower. It can be a rose, a lily, different styles, different genres, but you're doing the same kind of thing, making music and making honey, which is maybe a nice bridge to Lucky Fonz, because not only because one of your albums is called Hoe Honing Maakt, to make honey.
How to make honey.
But also because you have played with different styles, different genres. Maybe we can watch first a compilation of some of the things you have done. And then I will ask you about how you relate to your...
I don't like heaven to swim. I don't like heaven to swim. I don't like to swim, no, especially not at night. I don't like heaven to swim. Ik heb een meisje en het is zo'n lieve schat. En als ik aan haar denk, dan denk ik oh, 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 zo mooi.
Oh, Diana, ik weet het zeker sinds je naar me kijkt. Oh, was het even, het is alsof je zei vanaf nu wil ik alleen nog maar jou. Hoe ben je, hoe je, ja weet.
Oh, Diana. Ja, dat was een rare tijd. Er werden heel veel mensen ziek. En bij sommigen was het zaad te zien. Bij anderen dan weer niet. En de drugs gingen in de rondte. Alsof het koffie was. In een kleine groep van 30 man. Onze nachtelijke klas.
So the first clip we saw was one of your songs, Lampedusa. It could be referred to as a contemporary protest song. Second one was Ik heb een meisje, a Dutch song. The third one, a cooperation with Dutch hip-hopper Campy. And the last clip from your latest album, the song A Rare Tijd, in which you also use, like you said yourself, electronica.
Yes. So like Barbara said, it apparently it's only a difference in sound, right?
Yeah.
For me as an artist, you just look, you take the sound you want, but like I'm also smart enough to be aware that my choices, that they have like political implications. This synth means things, you know, the fact that I'm a folk singer and then all of a sudden I use that synthesizer, it means things. I know people are going to look at it and say, oh, his soul is gone.
Yeah?
He's lost it, yeah. Like I just said, I got an email today saying precisely that. And I know why this is. It's because synths are associated with the 80s and the 90s, and they're like uncool periods of time for a certain group of age. They're not 60s, do you know what I mean? They're not real. Because the thing with Bob Dylan, the know, these things changed over time, this notion of authenticity, because Bob Dylan, like, you know, at that moment, it was seen as an inauthentic thing to do.
Yeah.
But now, in hindsight, it's emblematic of something very authentic. We say Bob Dylan is a truly authentic artist because he did that.
He dared to break with the existing convention.
It's the exact same happening, just being a symbol of the exact opposite.
Yeah,
because times change, like, you know, gardens change.
So for you, that is a way of creating your personal authenticity to break with conventions and try something new?
Well, I don't care for authenticity. I don't think an artist should care for it.
Okay,
because it's like the moment you strive for it, it's going to be gone. The moment you're going to sit down and think, what do I have to do to be authentic? That's the moment the very moment you do that, you start being inauthentic.
Yeah.
It's like, you know.
So does that mean that you don't think about it? Or do you think about it at some point?
Well, I think about it, but only in terms of perception of the way other people see me. Because you know that, you can sort of navigate that and maybe use it to your own advantage. I know if I have like a folk record out, I know I need certain photos to go with that. Okay. Do you know what I mean? Like,
but how do you know this?
Well, because you know, as a musician, you're also a student of music and music history. I've read everything with Bob Dylan. I think Bob Dylan was being at that time was being provocative. I think he was maybe, like, maybe not intentionally, but you know, he was certainly following his heart and yeah. I mean, you can navigate it once you know it, as long as you don't navigate it artistically.
Mm-hmm.
You can sort of think what. You can think about what an audience expects of you, but I think you shouldn't think about it too much.
Does that maybe also mean that you sometimes have to negotiate between your own thoughts or your own feelings about authenticity what the audience thinks or people working in the industry? Maybe?
Yes. Well, you have to deal with it. Maybe you don't have to negotiate it, or maybe you have to. Maybe the word is to bear it. You have to bear it. Like, to tell you a personal example, like I started out as like a very serious folk musician, but I like to make jokes in between the songs.
Yeah.
This was not done for a folk musician, because like people point at that and say, well, he's not authentic because he's not being a serious songwriter.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we expect a songwriter to behave in a certain way that will somehow prove his authenticity. But I fought from a young. I fought. You know, I've always fought. Making a joke doesn't make me me or my songs any less authentic, does it? I mean, like, how does that even work? So I thought I'll make the jokes anyway, and then people would sort of. There was a certain type of crowd that did not like me because of that reason. So it had nothing to do with music at all.
Yeah.
So it has nothing to do with music.
No, but sometimes you lose audiences then, and you have to.
Yeah, but you have to bear it. Because the funny thing is, if I were to say, I'm not going to make any jokes anymore, because then I won't be authentic anymore, that's when I'm really inauthentic, you know? There's a paradoxical side to it. Like the more you try to be, if you think about these notions and you behave, you know, towards that notion, that's inauthentic.
Yeah.
And the funny thing is, you see a lot of people do that, and they get away with it. They get applauded for an authenticity that's obviously performance.
Mm. Yeah. When I look at you both, I see actually many similarities. I know less about you than I know about Kudsi, that's the obvious. But what I hear you say, that basically you find your own artistic signature by studying the culture, a culture of Bob Dylan, and I see the same happening with Kudsi. And from there, you start and building your musical identity. How do you feel about that?
Sure.
Do you think that every artist should have this background to draw from?
No.
That feeds
him? No, I don't think so, because it's not up to me what an other artist should do. Maybe if somebody can sort of exist without a sense of tradition, that's fine. But I've always found it fascinating and interesting. And also, tradition gives you a lot of sort of, you know, every time somebody says to me, you're not authentic, I say, that's what they said about Bob Dylan. Do you know what I mean? Like, and that's the tradition I'm in. So if there's a crowd saying I'm not authentic, then it means I'm doing the right thing.
So you're not responding with saying Judas.
Yeah, it's also a way of it's a way of dealing with you. Yeah.
And may I ask also, Kudsi, what is, or don't we have time anymore? What your opinion is about that?
Yes, sure.
Well, I should say, if we look to somebody who becomes poet, he needs to learn a language to say his feelings, no? So you have people which they study literature, so they know thousands of poems, but they are not poet. You can have an ignorant peasant, he says things, becomes a very important poetry to be studied in the universities afterward. But the problem, now the young people, because the modernity asks to be quick, so people, they don't want to learn anything, and they want to say, I'm going to be authentic, I don't need to learn anything, and I just play self-made, and it's authentic. I don't agree with this. Music is an art. You have to learn the language of this art. So whatever you do afterward is your problem. But you have, for example, in France, people like Michel Portal. He plays concerto of clarinet of Mozart, but he can also make contemporary music that he composed himself. So it doesn't mean that he loses authenticity in one language, but he has a background. So I think this background, especially in a music school like this, is necessary. I would not encourage my students and people in this school to say, just play what you feel. That's not the thing to do, I think.
Okay. Maybe it's an opportunity to open it up to the public. We have 5 more minutes for questions. From the audience, is there someone who likes to ask a question to either Mr. Erguner or to Lucky Fonz? Yes, there in the back.
Hello, good evening. I'm Nicole Jordan. I actually hear 2 different topics here. One is authenticity in music, and then one is authenticity as an artist. Can you talk about that a little bit? Because it seems that they're quite entangled right now.
Yeah. Okay.
I think that's a really good question. Because the thing is, I think authenticity in music is basically a given. So it's something you're born with, and it's a default setting. Right?
What do you mean by that?
Well, you know, like I just said, as long as you don't think about authenticity as a musician in your work as a musician, you will always be authentic, right? And then, like Barbara just said, but if you will be perceived as authentic, it's a different thing. Like Barbara said, that this is something that is decided outside of you. You have no artistic influence over that because there is no such, there's no like absolute rule of this is what authenticity means. Because who's to say that? You can't decide that. So I think for me, this has always been very clear-cut thing. I think I've always thought, like, as long as I artistically don't bother with even thinking about authenticity, I'm going to be fine. I literally won't have to need to bother it. Like, at the moment, I only think about it for myself as like a PR kind of thing. Do you know, like I know that if I do this, it will be perceived as authentic. Yeah. And sometimes you do that. It's theatrical. It's a performance.
Okay, so it's not really relevant when you're creating or making music, but
no,
when
I
you're
think it's something
opening
to be
your
avoided.
Music up to the public.
I think it's to be avoided. I think when you're creating music and you're going to think, oh, I need to be authentic, that's bad news.
Okay. Last question, maybe. Yes, over there.
Yeah, I have a question about the Sufi music. You said you emphasized the listeners a lot, and when you said if I play the music for a Sufi audience, it is Sufi music. What happens if you play the Sufi music for a non-Sufi audience?
I can answer to your question. For example, if you go to a concert to listen a requiem, okay, do you ask to the musicians if they are really good Catholics? And the musician doesn't ask to the public if they are good Catholics also. So why you ask this question when it's the subject is another culture than yours? Because that's the always the problem, because looking from outside, you want to have the authentic thing. Like the tourism, you know, you go to any country, you have to buy something, you don't want to be treated as a tourist. You want to have authentic things. But this question is completely false, because what is important is the music itself. So if the music, what is the criteria for a music to be authentic? It has its rules. I mean, listen, for example, I give you an example. I was invited to a festival of sacred music in France, and the president of this festival was a minister. He invites me to his office, and he asked me to play something very light because the public is not used to this. And I saw in the program there was Requiem also. And I asked to him, would you ask to the conductor of this orchestra to play a bit faster to don't make bored people? So that's always the problem, because the fact that you look for an authenticity, you want, when it's some music outside of the European culture, you want to have easygoing things. And if it's easygoing, you go into it and you think that it's authentic. But there are many borrowing things that you can appreciate if you make an effort.
Thank you very much. Please give an applause to Mr. Erguner and to Lucky Fonz III. Now, like I said in my introduction, Mr. Erguner is also going to perform to you together with his companion, Michalis Cholevas. Can you maybe also come to the stage? So if we say that authenticity is not intrinsic to music or musicians, but rather that it is a social construction, so that it is up to the audience and people working in the music industry, as we have heard in the previous interview, then people working in the music industry, critics, journalists, radio DJs, and label owners probably are some of the key players in assessing and labeling what is authentic and what is not. But how does this actually work? How, as a gatekeeper, as an intermediary, do you distinguish between what is real and what is fake? And what mechanisms are underlying such decisions? These and more questions we will be discussing with George Caird and Koen ter Heegde. George Caird is an oboist, teacher and educator. In 1987, he became head of woodwind and orchestral studies at the Royal Academy of Music and was appointed as principal of Birmingham Conservatory in 1993, a post he held for 17 years. In 2001, through to the present, he was appointed as musical director of the Rotterdam Classical Music Academy at Codarts, Rotterdam. Please give a warm welcome to George Caird. Mr. Caird will be joined by Koen ter Heegde, who studied arts, culture and media at the University of Groningen and is both a co-founder and label manager of the Groningen-based indie label Subroutine Records, home of some of the most popular indie acts in the Netherlands, such as Rats on Rafts, Naïef Zet and The Homesick and Wolven. Please put your hands together for Koen ter Heegde. Welcome, George and Koen. Koen, to start with you, we've made a compilation of music clips of acts that are affiliated to your label, Subroutine Records.
I suggest that we first watch this movie clip, and then I will ask you afterwards to explain what actually is indie music, because your label is an indie label. Let's first watch this clip. Rats on Wrath, Naive Set, and The Homesick, indie bands. What is indie music?
The term indie music or independent music, it's very old. It was used already when basically what I want to say is, like, as a record label, for us to be an independent record label, we look at what were the independent record labels in the past. At one point in Manchester, there was a group called the Buzzcocks, one of the original punk bands, and they decided for the first time, all right, we're not gonna move to London, where most of the music industry is based, but we're gonna self-release our own music, which became the Spiral Scratch EP, and it was a revolution because all of a sudden bands took that power to themselves.
So independent means that you're sort of outside of the mainstream music industry.
Independent means that there is something that is opposed to that, which is a larger music industry with major record labels and all those things, and a lot of marketing budgets and all that stuff. I think over the years, the term indie became more or less a marketing tool, as it is now. It is also really hard to compare, for instance, this notion of authenticity with independent.
Okay, so that's increasingly more important to be independent of commercial music.
I think right now indie and independent is more a mentality than it is something that is based on, like, a real...
But is authenticity then still relevant in indie music as being rebellious towards the commercial music industry? Because you're also saying that this is becoming difficult.
Well, it's not becoming difficult to be indie. I mean, anybody can start a band and say we're now an indie band. And over the years, it also became more or less synonymous with music genres, indie rock.
Yeah.
For instance, but I think for us this authenticity thing is a gut thing, you know. You see a band, you discover a band, whether you see them play one of their first shows, which I had with the last video, where they were bombarding themselves with snack food from their village.
Yeah, the homesick.
And some of the times it's bands that have existed for a much longer time. Like for us. It's about, like, feeling it, because it's also we are a non-profit operation. All the money that comes in goes, like, into the piggy bank that is owned by all the musicians that are affiliated with us, and we also don't work with contracts.
Okay, but you're saying it's a gut feeling. But that's often that's a bit vague, of course, because what then is this is gut feeling? You're assessing bands, like. Being authentic or maybe less authentic.
I know that's not maybe not what people or you want to hear, but, like, for us the general thing is simple. If we like the band, if they're cool, we even use more vaguer terms sometimes, even say if the band rocks. I mean, that means nothing. Like, that's me. I mean, when you it's much harder to look at authenticity when you're talking about alternative guitar music, because there's a body of work that comes before that. Like, looking back on the first panel, there were a lot of things went through my mind in terms of also, like, cultural appropriation of a specific identity that belongs to a culture. When you have the Roma as a minority in the Western and in the larger Balkans,
yeah.
Gypsies as their what's that word like? Yeah, well, it's a very negative term. That's the
sure,
that's what
yeah.
I want to say. But you have Roma Ashkali music, which is still made, and people are looking for that. It's an authentic thing. People are longing for that because
yeah.
it's an identity. It's strong. But for instance, I think in the Western world, the most successful musician working with traditional Roma music was Goran Bregovic, for instance, who is himself not Roma, who included a lot of traditions and music and styles to a larger group and marketed that to the Western media as being authentic Rome, and people want that, so people believe that.
So you can also appropriate it.
Yeah.
We will return. Coco Bordel, he's
exactly
a big folk fan.
Yeah. It's exactly the same, I think.
Yeah.
That's very similar anyway.
We're coming back to this issue of assessing bands later, but first I also want to ask you if you, do you agree with Simon Reynolds? So his argument saying that popular music nowadays is suffering from retromania, because if you look at this video clips, it has this sort of nostalgic filter built within it. So you could say it's retromania, but do you agree with Simon Reynolds, or do you look at it differently?
I don't know. I don't have to agree or disagree with him. I mean, because what I look for is a specific, like I look for a band, a certain thing, what makes them great. And I think a lot of the bands that we release or that we are affiliated with, of course, incorporate a lot of different popular genres from the past.
Mm-hmm.
Like you can say that of any band we do.
Yeah.
But of course, you're looking for something that makes that extra. And but like I said, Retromania, of course, there is a body of work that people refer to, that people incorporate in their work, I believe.
Yeah.
And George, thanks. How does that work for classical music? Do you see a similarity with popular music? Because we also have a body of work that we refer to.
Is this on?
It is
can
on.
You hear me?
It is
yeah.
on. So your view on
well
Retromania.
Well, boy, do we have a body of work.
Yeah.
But one point I was going to say is that actually going back more than two centuries, the musician did everything. The musician wrote the music. The musician played the music. And what's happened is we've had a kind of fracturing over many years where we have performers and composers.
Mm-mm.
And that brings in complexity. So that's one thing. But I think we are suffering from retromania more and more. It's becoming more and more acute because the body of work is weighing down on us like Shakespeare does on actors and directors. I think that we are at a critical moment now, even just the last 10 years, when an evening like this is part of a new awareness, when we've turned a corner and maybe we're getting rid of that retromania, in my opinion.
Yeah,
so that's one thing to say.
Do you say that we're getting rid of retromania within classical music? So there are also other notions of authenticity instead of only recycling
okay.
the past? Could you maybe zoom out a bit?
Yeah.
Because you've
well
been working in the classical music field for 40 years. So you.
And it's a long time ago, yes, when we just simply played old music and didn't think about it. But Nicole is right, is that there were these two things, which was the authenticity to yourself or authenticity to the object that you're trying to produce. And I think in my time, of course, we've suffered from, not suffered, but we have had the phenomenon of the early music movement. And that has actually caused music to be looked at in forensic detail. And I think it's been a brilliant thing because it actually has brought us a huge amount of information to the fore. But it has caused some musicians problems because it has negated maybe their own voice within this investigation, possibly.
Mm.
And it's a question of the balance you trade between the two things of being true to the origin of the work itself or true to your own ideas about that work itself.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think the exciting thing, the turning of the corner, is that it is a continuum now from absolute fidelity to complete originality and everything in between.
Yeah, yeah. And besides a musician, you're also an educator. How do you see the role of education in training musicians for this market of authenticity in classical music, where you have staying true to the traditional heritage on the one hand and trying to play with it or innovate it on the other?
Well, can I say, there's one thing I would like to say, because I have been really inspired by this evening. I've been inspired by the film. I've been inspired by Lucky, your film. But this beautiful music played by Michalis and by Kudsi. And what I'd like to say is, as an oboe player to Kudsi, is you have such a beautiful voice on your instrument. And there's one thing that we need to talk about in terms of authenticity is this deep, innate ability, feeling to produce music. And we heard that tonight. We really, really heard it tonight. And that is one thing that one would always in education want to look for and encourage. It's the voice of the individual person that counts. But going back to your other thing is, what I would say is, in education now, we try to make sure that everyone seeks the most information they can. Find out about what you are doing. Find out everything about what you're doing if you can. And then do your thing. And that is completely different. And it is the synthesis of these two dimensions which I think produces magic.
So the synthesis between?
Between total information, i.e. inform yourself and gain skill. Listen to the brilliant skillful playing that we heard tonight. If it's not skillful, it is not interesting. But then it is reaching deep inside yourself for those things which cannot be spoken about, which is your voice. And we've heard many people touching on this this evening. The trueness to you, which could be to do with your parents. It could be to do with your teacher. Nobody has talked this evening really about the teacher. But do you know that I knew an old lady. 10 years ago, she played a recital on the piano, aged 93. She went back in 5 hops to Beethoven because she learnt with a woman called Leonie Gombrich, who learnt with Lechkatitsky, who learnt with Czerny, who learnt with Beethoven, who learnt with Mozart, actually. So we have to remember that we musicians are all a patchwork of informations which are being passed to us consciously or subconsciously. I think that's really exciting. And it's the role of educators to be part of some kind of chain, but which releases an individual in the end to be themselves.
And besides a musician and an educator, you've also been involved in a lot of committees as a committee members.
Yep.
So, like Koen, you are also assessing musicians.
Yep.
Is authenticity then an important factor? And is this the same kind of gut feeling as Koen was talking about? Can you maybe explain this a little bit?
It's a gut feeling. I agree with you. 3 people come in and play or sing, and then you know. But actually, I do think it comes down to these categories. If there is no skill, you have to forgive them the lack of skill, don't you? And if there is absolutely no understanding of what they are doing, you know they don't understand the words if they are singing, what do you do about that? But then there is the ingredient X. When you know that individual is doing something which moves you, and that is the most important ingredient. Okay. So my feeling is that there are those 3 broad categories. A fourth category might be, what do you look like on stage? You know, does it look fun and nice to...
The performative aspect. Yeah.
But number one is it skillful? Number two, is it informed about what it's doing? And remember, information could be on a drum kit. Does the drum kit player know enough about that actual use of the stick? It could be that kind of detailed information. It could also be really knowing about what Chopin was thinking when he wrote Mazurka.
For me, it's very interesting because of I think at the way I operate in the Netherlands, and it's not just a record label. It's I organize tours, exchanges with the Balkans,
yeah.
A lot of different things. I'm on the other side of the spectrum. For me, it's basically skill. It would never be the first for me. It's like what emotion brings this to me.
Okay.
What is the intention of the musician?
Well, I agree with that.
Yeah, yeah. Maybe because we've made a movie clip showing two different bands from the Netherlands. You've asked us to make a compilation of it, and you would like to explain like the difference between what, according to you, is could be designated as authentic and what could be designated as
it's
less
about
authentic.
What people perceive.
Exactly.
As authenticity.
Maybe we can watch the clip and then maybe you can explain it a bit more afterwards. To explain these movie clips in relation to authenticity?
Okay, well, first of all, looking aside the obvious differences in genres, I mean, it's about influences. Like the first band we watched was a Dutch band called The X, who made a lot of music together with an Ethiopian saxophone player called Getachew Mekuria. And the second band is an Amsterdam formation called Jungle by Night. Who I think have a conservatory background and also include a lot of the influences from Afrobeat and Western African music into their total mixture. But what I think is the fun part of these two bands is that they reach completely different audiences and they have a completely different background in how they incorporate these influences. Mm-hmm. The X started out like I think somewhat 40 years ago as a punk band that literally couldn't play anything. They picked up the guitars and couldn't do anything. So there is no that skill aspect.
Yeah.
They developed their own language, which they then after the guitar player, the oldest member Terry, when he went on a honeymoon trip with his wife all the way from like Cairo to South Africa. And like that formed him in a way, and also made him change his language, but on a very bottom-up way, because mm-hmm. it's finding it's a very emotional way of performing. He also does a lot of improv stuff, so that's also. But with Jungle by Night, who is an extremely popular band from the Netherlands, it's one of our most successful export products, I think. But they have this conservatory background with in which they of course got a lot of these influences in, but I think the audience perceives the X in this way, and this is all very much around this notion of authenticity. The X is like credible, original, and I think a lot of people, I mean, we're not talking about mainstream audiences here, because we're talking about people that get into this stuff, mm-hmm. like us, I would presume, because otherwise you wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be here. I think that's a very interesting issue.
Can I ask you a little bit about the conservatory background that you're referring to? Does that mean for you that it makes their music less credible to you?
It's not to me, but I think in the Netherlands, especially also in media and in what was original, this indie audiences mm-hmm. from the mm-hmm. 90s, I think it was up until about 2005 or something that people who came from the conservatory and started like a punk band or an alternative guitar band were very uncredible, mm-hmm. uncool.
And
because
can
they
you
went
can you
to
explain
school.
That? Can you explain
I don't know why that is, but what the interesting thing is is how that changed that
yeah,
perception.
But you know what the interesting thing also is, because I happen to know some of these guys from Jungle by Night, and the band was formed before the majority of the band members were admitted to the conservatory. So how do you explain that?
I don't explain anything.
No, but you're referring to their conservatory background, while the band started when they were not.
Because if you I didn't choose this specific example for nothing. Because if you Google the interviews with the band, conservatory is almost in every
medium.
Yeah,
that's 10 years later. So 10 years later. But they were an overnight success when they started, and they were not in conservatory yet. So that's what I think.
Yeah, but so can I have a go at that?
Of course.
Because I think what you're saying, because you use the word influence, is that somehow a band might have a direct, pure link to something mysterious that feeds them. And a conservatoire could be teaching that band all sorts of stuff, Schenkerian analysis and, contemporary musics and old musics, which somehow gets in the way of this pure connection. And I think in a way, what the conservatoire movement has done is to explain that it doesn't need to do that, I think. The pure links with influence can remain, and you can continue to develop yourself in many, many different platforms. But it's really interesting to hear you say that, because I think the credibility and the originality and the connection thing is what is so vital to this notion.
Yeah, also,
of authenticity.
I got the feeling that it's something. I mean, for me, this is not personal. I don't know these guys.
No.
But what I'm talking about is how they are perceived in the media.
Exactly. So once it becomes
and by the people that actually like.
It's still with
the
perception.
Once it becomes institutional.
Or maybe a prejudice.
Are there maybe questions in the audience? Yes.
This isn't about Jungle by Night. Why this obsession with Simon Reynolds? This idea of retromania. I think this is mad that people keep going on about Simon's book, that it is some sort of Bible, because what I get from that book is the idea that, what I get from the way that people interpret it, shall we say, is the idea that old time is good and new time is, you know, less relevant, shall we say. And a lot of what I've heard tonight is seem to have time as a concept, as a static concept, whereas the idea of authenticity or what have you, it's effectively a moving feast, isn't it? It happens in the time, it happens in the moment when you experience music. So the idea that you can judge time to be a lot better in 1989 or 1977 or 1963, you know, these are retrospective judgments, aren't they? And isn't this makes a lot of the arguments that Simon throws up somewhat arbitrary?
Yeah, and who's this question? For who's this
question? Just a lot of you.
For all of us.
I think I received that comment very, very openly. I think you're right. I think time is an extraordinarily complex thing to deal with. I think what you're saying is that authenticity for many of us is something that we perceive in a moment. Precisely. And it has a multiple set of meanings, is what I've learned tonight. Some people have said maybe there are two or three meanings, but I think there could be many, many blended meanings to this word authenticity. But it doesn't mean that it's a cheap word. It's a phenomenal feeling and concept which somehow we have to address, because when publics are listening to artists, they sense this. And what is it? Well, I think it's really worth unpacking, especially if we are in the business of encouraging others to go forwards from here. But thank you for that. I think the question about time is right, and I think being in awe of the past is not necessarily helpful. But I would say myself that in education, it would be wrong to be not informed about the past. I think one should really address that.
Thank you. Final question or comment?
Yes. Thanks for a great evening. It was very inspiring. I had one question. And that's the thing about authority. We had Jungle by Night here in the grounds, and I remember it as the day of yesterday. It was, and we had Tony Allen on the same night. He was sitting right there, and Tony Allen was the drummer of Fela Kuti. And I remember very good that these young musicians were playing, you're right, from their inner voice, but also were playing from a tradition that were not their own, were looking very good through the window if Tony Allen would agree what they were playing. So that was really about, you know, about tradition and authority. And then I saw a sort, yeah, that it is hanging about, you know, authenticity is really about your inner voice, but it's also really about a tradition and something you shared and something maybe you get into yourself. And I don't really get to a question, but that's really what I remember from, and it's, I don't know how to grasp it, but maybe you can.
Yeah, that's exactly the issue with authenticity.
Yeah.
I have this question. So you have this punk guys, and then you have this conservatory guys. They know the theory, and then how does it happen with this conservatory people that they don't get into this, so to say, punk world? Does it has to do with when you know the rules so fucking well, don't you get too soul then? Something like that.
So
is
if you
it
know
clear
the
or not?
If you know the rules too well, you can't rock. Yeah,
you can't soul. You can't find the soul when you know the rules too well. So you have to get rid of the rules. First you learn about the rules, and then you get rid of it, and then there's appearing some soul, maybe. Yeah.
Koen?
I mean, if you look at the soul as the famous soul musicians from the past, everybody is always referring to the Aretha Franklins or the Al Greens or the Marvin Gayes. Of everybody that starts singing like that now is always referred to as that, and that's also something what the gentleman there said. I mean, it's you cannot step away from that.
Yeah.
So you cannot.
No. Wait a moment. For instance, in classical music, there has to be some soul as well. So. No, soul.
Soul. Right. Of course,
feeling.
That has to be. Yeah.
Feeling.
So it's not a question of theory versus soul. I mean, the whole thing has to be together. But actually, I'm thinking of that wonderful story about George Gershwin. You know, George Gershwin went to the composer Maurice Ravel, and he asked him for lessons. Did you know that? So George Gershwin was already famous, and the Ravel, of course, famous too. But George Gershwin said, "I recognize you as kind of the great composer. Can you give me lessons?" And Ravel said, "George, how much do you earn?" And when they shared their earnings, he said, "You don't need to come anywhere near me for lessons." Because in a sense, George Gershwin, of course, was completely him, and he required nothing from Ravel, according to Ravel. And I would say to the rock thing, yes, it's true. If my brain is full of rules, I'm not going to rock. But I hope that somehow I can absorb as many rules and information as I can, and then I release and rock. Mm. I would like to go away from tonight to say we are all here because we are passionate about music, and the highest thing is that we should rock or have soul or sing or communicate. But I think also when we are training people, for heaven's sake, let's try and be as informed as we can about it.
So we're coming back to where Koen started, that you can first appropriate things and then create something authentic.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much, Koen ter Heegde and George Caird. Okay, we're going to the final round of interviews. So you, if you want to leave the stage, and you get a nice present from Sushi. No, you can stay if you want. Okay, during this final round, we will take a helicopter perspective and zoom out to explore the link between authenticity, its history in romanticism, and broader dynamics in contemporary society. You might be surprised, but according to our last guest of tonight, authenticity is not only relevant in popular music, but also in religion, in beer commercials, and in politics. Our last guest is Professor Dick Houtman, who is full professor of sociology of culture and religion at the Center for Sociological Research at the University of Leuven in Belgium. As a cultural sociologist, to quote from his website, he aims to expose intellectual pretensions of true meaning solidly grounded beyond culture and history as moral discourse disguised as science. Please give a big round of applause to Dick Houtman. So, Dick, you've been listening all night. Could you maybe reflect on some of the things that you found interesting, that sparked your attention?
Can everybody hear me? Yeah? Well, what a couple of people brought up, and I think that's a vital thing, that is this distinction between, say, being true to an origin, to a tradition, to a community, to a culture. So basically being part of it and representing it in an authentic way, and how that is completely different, eventually maybe incompatible with authenticity and a sense of originality, breaking the rules, breaking traditions, transgressing boundaries, trying to make something that is not traditional, but that is, well, completely new, so to say. The interesting example of Bob Dylan, for instance, I mean, of course, all these folk people find it completely inauthentic when he goes electric. But on the other hand, you could argue going electric as a folk musician, that's the most authentic thing you can do, right?
Yeah, like Lucky also said.
Yeah. Exactly. I mean, if you start playing Sufi music, not with a ney flute, but with a saxophone, for instance, mm-hmm. I mean, then you're not, inscribing yourself, so to say, into that tradition of Sufi music. In that way, it is not authentic Sufi music, but as an artist, you're doing something that is weird and that is new and that's completely original and authentic in that sense. So the distinction between, say, authenticity in the sense of being true to a tradition on the one hand, and authenticity in the sense of personal authenticity, mm-hmm. being original, making something new, that's an important distinction, and it's almost incompatible, I would say, these two.
The two different kind of definitions of authenticity. So you're a professor in cultural sociology.
Yeah.
You're specialized in contemporary forms of religion, new forms of religion after Christianity. But you're also specialized in authenticity, which are comparable according to you. Could you maybe explain a little bit more about how you see a link between religion and authenticity?
I'm not sure whether I'm really specialized in religion. I mean, it's one of the issues that I study and I find quite interesting. And every topic I study, I mean, the underlying theme, the fascination is always this dimension of authenticity that you find in a popular culture, in consumer culture, in religion, in politics. You basically find it in all different societal realms. But talking about religion, I mean, if you nowadays ask people in Western Europe, are you a religious person? Well, then the most likely answer is, of course, no. But a second most likely answer will be something like, no, I'm not religious, but I am quite interested in spirituality. Or people will even say, no, I'm not religious because I want to follow my personal spiritual path. So that means something like, I don't want to be part of something that already exists, a tradition. I don't want to be like all the others, like Brian we just saw, right? Mm-hmm. I don't want to conform to a sort of pre-given order, but I want to break away from that. I don't want to be religious like others. I want to pursue my personal spiritual path. So clearly in the West nowadays, you can see that in the field of religion, authenticity has become a very big thing. And then especially authenticity in the second sense I just mentioned. Originality, being different from others, not conforming to a tradition, but breaking away from it. So in that sense, in the religious field, authenticity has become a very big thing.
Yeah, yeah. You just said that authenticity can be found in various societal domains, in religion, but also in other domains. And one of the domains is, for instance, popular music, the popular music industry, but also, as you mentioned during a pre-interview with you, within the beer industry. And we brought an example of this. Let's first watch this movie clip.
Or be killed. And all that mattered was survival.
Beer commercial. What does this have to do with authenticity, according to you?
Quite a lot, I would say. I mean, the first part was missing, but in the first part, you see these men in their offices and at washing machines, doing all sort of things that are not typically masculine, right? And you see these men thinking and realizing how alienated they have become, how over-civilized they have become, how they are not real men anymore. And once they realize that that they have been civilized, have been trimmed, have been disciplined into all sorts of roles that they are expected to play. As soon as they realize that, they decide to break out of that. And then happens, what you just saw. And the interesting thing is that this is almost a direct reference to Rousseau. Rousseau, the godfather of romanticism, and some argue the inventor of the notion of authenticity. I mean, authenticity for Rousseau, that is primitive cultures, primitive societies, living in close harmony with nature, unspoiled by civilization, modernity, technology. That's the idea of the noble savage. And that's very much what you see here. I mean, as soon as they realize how they are not themselves anymore, basically, they are not themselves as men, but they have become sissies, wimps. As soon as they realize, where do they go? Well, they go to nature, right? I mean, that's a reference, of course, to the nature that is supposed to be within them. Their real masculine nature, who they are as men. They would hunt animals with teeth as long as their arms, as a quote from the beginning of this commercial. This is very clearly a reference, I would say, to romanticism and longing for authenticity, longing to be who you really are as men. And then the interesting thing here, of course, is that it's all very overdone, very exaggerated, it's ridiculous, it's funny. And that's, of course, also also interesting about this commercial, because as soon as a commercial start saying, well, you're a man, so what you want is drink beer with the boys. That's what real men do. Maybe you're not aware of that, but that's what you want. I mean, as soon as a commercial starts telling what is authentic and what you should do, well, that's not very credible, of course. So you see many commercials, this is one example, where these claims about what it means to be authentically male in this instance, then there is always a second text needed, a subtext, that of course that is not true, that it's ironic, that it's meant to be funny. So the message is brought across, being male means that you want to drink with the guys. That's not what we are making up here. That's really true. That is male nature. But at the same time, I mean, that's completely politically incorrect, of course. So you need a couple of winks and a lot of irony and exaggeration to show that you're not really serious in making this claim. So you see many commercials like that today. On the one hand, goods can only be sold if they are endowed with auras of authenticity. Some lettuce nowadays, any lettuce you buy has been harvested by hand by an old lady on the southern slopes of Mount Etna in Sicily. Everything is handmade according to ancient family recipes and all that sort of stuff. But you run the risk, of course, as an advisor, that people think that you try to make them believe that that's really true, and then such a commercial doesn't work at all. And that's when the irony comes in, as in this case.
Yeah, if we go back to popular music, because you're referring to Rousseau's Noble Savage as an example of or an exemplar of authenticity. So going back to the origin of man. But of course, in popular music, also musicians, they also use personas. And some of them make use of them a lot. David Bowie, Madonna, for instance, also Lady Gaga. And they are regarded by their fans as being truly authentic. But it seems like it's the opposite of the origin of man, because it's artificiality. Do you think that artificiality can also be an exemplar of authenticity?
That's a very good question, very difficult as well.
I'm sorry.
Well, I would say that these personas that are played by a particular artist demonstrate a strong tendency to transgress boundaries, to be not just one single person, but to be basically different every day. Mm-hmm. With every record, there is a new persona. So that is authentic in a sense of breaking away from roles. I mean, Lucky Fonz referred to that. Mm-hmm. There is always a particular moment, of course, when fans expect a particular type of music. And from that moment on, you're basically stuck with that. You become a prison of the own authenticity that you have created. And that's exactly the point where authenticity becomes performed, becomes staged, mm-hmm. becomes inauthentic, basically. And one way to break through that problem is, of course, by changing personas all the time, or changing genres of music you play. Mm-hmm. I mean, the songs by Lucky Fonz that we saw were all very different. I mean, whether it's acoustical folk music, at the first instance, and the later ones are very different from that. And then, of course, there will always be parts of the audience who will say, well, this is not authentic. Mm-hmm. Why don't you just do why we like you?
Yeah. Right? So it remains in the eye of the beholder.
Yeah.
There's a room for one question from the audience. Is there someone? Yes, in the back. It's Twan again, yes?
So we all, as musicians, I'm not a musician, but they all have to metaphorically read Ovidius Metamorphoses and use it as a guide through the world of characters, or how do you call it?
Persona.
I call it alias.
Yeah. aliases. Well, the difficult thing with authenticity, of course, is that it's a very slippery concept. I mean, if we have seen one thing tonight, then it's precisely this. How, as Dylan going electric, that's completely authentic, but by other groups it's called completely inauthentic. So basically everything is possible. So that means one way of being authentic as an artist is following your own intuition as an artist and doing whatever you like and changing and developing and playing different roles and different persona. Another way of doing it is, well, staying close to a particular persona, to who you as an artist, who you really are, as a sort of trademark, so that you immediately recognize the artist. But it's two incompatible ways, but both can be used to authenticate a musician, I would say.
Okay, Dick, thank you very much for being here and sharing your thoughts with us. Please give Dick Houtman a big round of applause again. Then we have almost come to the end of this event. It's of course nice to talk about music, but maybe it's even nicer to play music and perform music. So Lucky Fonz, he is going to perform a few songs of him. And I would like to give the stage back to Lucky Fonz III.
Thank you. Thank you. And an earlier crowd had come to see me win my prize, and I felt like I deserved it, like it was justice in my eyes. But the only thing that I could think was, what am I gonna do when all of this is over, when my days of hope are through? But now I am somebody else, with golden books upon my shelves and diamonds on my mind.